All right. Day 6. Feeling a little bit better today. Got a lot more rest than usual. Alright, a little bit of change of plans. We're gonna ramp up from 160. We'll see if that warm up is a little bit better. Yesterday's warm up was not the hottest. But we'll try a pyramid structure for the next couple days. We're still gonna start at 160 though. Probably not any lower than that. Okay, that is a lot rougher than I thought, but still better than yesterday's warm up. Oh, you know what would be a great addition to at least the base osu? I wonder if they add it to osu laser. Where they separate, they assign early and late timing. They separate them. And then when you break, assign a late sound and an early sound. Because I wouldn't mind, since the hit sound is just one for me, it would be cool to have a late and an early sound. Then I know if I'm early or late, and I could make like a slight pitch up and a slight pitch down on the hit sound for like early green, early 100s and late 100s. So whenever it's late, I'll pitch down the hit sound, and when it's early, I pitch up the hit sound. So it makes it sound like high pitch as an early pitch, and low pitch as an late sound. That would be kind of nice. You can like insert one hit sound and maybe even implement it. One hit sound and it just auto pitches up and auto pitches down for slow and early. I don't know if it's an OC laser, but just the thought came across my mind just now. As opposed to like always constantly looking below or feeling out whether you're early or late. That was a pretty good warm-up. I think the lowest warm-up I would probably want to stick to is probably this. As we cool down all the way to this. Let's start this. Pretty decent one. Thank hoppers. Not bad. I can always rely on 140. 140 and 150 has generally been my startup warm-up thing for any map for over a year now, so that seemed pretty comfortable. 160 on triples seemed like it's reasonable, but it's still really uncomfortable. Alright, we're gonna warm up twice on both, I guess. Yeesh. It was a little struggle in the end. It was burning out pretty hard. A little warm up. I want to warm up without feeling like it's a struggle. This is most definitely not a struggle. We're definitely aiming low on here. But we want to keep, want to build up a structure. Gotta feel the warm up, yeah, indeed. Finished it. I think it's really cool. Did you get all the like the little side objectives and stuff? I thought it was really wonderful that they added the little like the guitar guy. I really like the guitar guy. Very. They did a lot of tricks, a lot of VFX tricks. I think it's impressive what they could achieve with their group, like the size of their group. There's a lot of artistic choices made to make the game look like that. I hope they make a sequel because it looks like there could be more with the world that they're building. Since they're an indie group, I feel like they're just establishing a universe. So it would be fun to see if they go into a different genre of gaming and build around that post-apocalyptic world that they created, like create another game where it deals with like the TV people, like the robots, and or like see if there were actually any humans left and whatnot. There's a lot of copium with that game. It's like super sad, but happy and sad at the same time. It's really sad. In the end, it's like a really sad game, in my opinion. It's hopeful, but super sad. I kind of really like those type of games where there's a bigger picture, but the game constantly teases you that there's something bigger that's in it. But since you're a cat, you can't be bigger than the sum of, you know, your impression. So it leaves you wanting more. Like, what happened? What happened to everything? It's the different other type of post-apocalyptic. I think a lot of times games that are set in a sci-fi post-apocalyptic setting, they tend to be like doom and gloom. Everything happened. Like, there are mean people and everyone's struggling and whatnot. But the way that game paved it is more like people are going on with their lives, and or, you know, like the creatures that are still alive. And they're like celebrating the little moments in pretty much a sucky disposition they have, but they're still like, it's very hopeful, but it's also very dreary and morbid. So it was nice. I really like their art direction. They could have just made it like a really doom and gloom stuff, like hopelessness and whatnot, but the choice of having a cat and the way the robots are, they're charming in a sense that it offsets how depressing the setting is. And they did it all without technically spoken humans involved, you know? If you wanted to make a silent protagonist that tells a story, a cat is a really good example. I mean, it also says a lot about, like, what is Link in Legends of Zelda? It's a voiceless protagonist. So it's kind of making a statement where it doesn't even have to be a human. If your character is voiceless and personalityless, that cat has more personality. I'm not throwing shade, but it's just like a different genre and different type of story. That cat has more personality than a voiceless protagonist that you use as a placeholder, as a plot, as an observer of plot devices. So, just goes to show you, you can still have a very voiceless protagonist, but still exude a lot of things, exude a lot of emotion. All right. So now we're kind of sort of warmed up. We're still warming up though. Had to rest a little bit. Like ahead of this. Why? I get ahead of this thing. I'm not like closing in. I'm starting on the... Hold on. Ugh. Okay. Like the single taps, the 1-2s, the 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. I actually switch and use my pointer finger to start on those. And it's like my middle finger isn't timing properly on the 1-2, 1-2. It's like late, early, late, early, late, early. But it's just enough in OD6 that it's on time late. Or like it's acceptable late, acceptable early. I'm not quite getting them close enough together. I need to shrink it up. But it does help me rest my middle finger from the triples. Alright. Anyways. It's still warm up still. Although I'm feeling a little bit sore already. Oh yeah. That soreness. My biggest question for Stray is, what happened to the dogs?
Video.
know what I would really, you know what I would do for free? Well, I guess it's not really for free, but it would be kind of cool for certain devs to, I know digital sales are very important, but the thing that prevents me from just like going crazy and just reviewing games left and right and whatnot really deals with it. It would be cool to somehow have a criteria to fill in order to receive a game for free. Like, I would love to exchange a task to do for the game, as opposed to like, okay, well, I clearly can't afford this game, right? Like $60 all the time, but what can I do to offset those $60? And it would create like a invest forward, invest back thing. Like first one, I don't know, say an indie dev would be like, oh yeah, we need a game to promote, get more games into the hands of people so that they would spread the word, right? But what can any person do willingly to fulfill a contractual duty to receive the game, but at the same time pay, the dev is paying forward, investing forward in someone, as opposed to the other way around where the dev has all the things to lose, so giving, they have to trust that they get sponsor someone who has a following that could just be as dangerous to the dev's investment than improve its investment. For example, when a dev has to trust someone who has a great influence, right? That they like the game. Because if they dislike the game, it blows back, right? There's a chance there's a blowback. But what about the other way, where devs start a program, or a client or storefront starts a program where, hey, you can't afford this game, right? But you absolutely love game. Here's another alternative way to get a chance to play this game, maybe even own it permanently. If you do these specific tasks, I would be totally up for that type of program. Because I think it's not because I technically can't afford the game, is I'm not willing to buy the game because I have to invest forward as well. So in both cases, the person is hoping that the $60 value they get from buying the game, they're investing forward and hoping to get that 60 value. The dev is also in that same position, but one could make an interface by saying, hey, we'll let you play this game for, I don't know, halfway or something, right? But we'll lock it behind where when you feel your contractual duty for pledging to create a specific content, I know there's going to be exploitations and all that stuff, but if they refine some standardization, once the person accomplishes that task, they gain access to the remainder of the game. And it would be a halfway point where the devs have some assurance that something is coming out of the investment forward, and the player, the person, the prospective fan or future fan also has an investment. It's closer than EA, like early access. Early access is getting close to there, where you invest forward as a gamer and the developer invests forward by cutting the price, right? Cutting the price by a bit. I just kind of want it to be even more even. It's like, for me, the only reason that stops me from playing games at launch, like any game at launch, is the idea that you're investing forward for an overall diminished return most of the time. And the devs would think the same when they're investing in someone who simply likes playing video games. not someone who's lucrative or popular. So in both cases, it's a lose-lose situation. Irregardless, the potential is lost. The potential for devs to expand their exposure of their game and for a passionate, for a someone who likes video game to be inspired to expand and aid in the devs' exposure of their game. So in both cases, it's just lost potential. It's also because both sides are mitigating diminished returns on their investment for it. Those are like kind of some of the thoughts that I was having whenever I, around this winter season, I'm going to be buying a lot of games, right? Or I'm hoping to buy two or three games, at least two games on launch, or like with a hefty price. But I see these reviews a lot of times where it reminds me of why the devs don't do what I'm suggesting, in a way, because so many I see these reviews like the product received for free, they played 100 hours, this game is trash, don't play it. That's what they get for investing forward. So I imagine there's got to be some sort of vetting process that would need to be in place, but typically the vetting process deals with how influential the target is. So if the person is really targeted, like influential, they're targeted, it can help them tremendously or it can backfire completely. And it's interesting that they there isn't a system that caters to consistency. So when you target someone who's less influential, who's less a prominent figure, typically they are more grateful and consistently look at it in a different perspective than like money, lucrativeness, and whatnot. So like it's interesting that there isn't a system that that brings together new devs and prospective influencers or consumers. Most of the stuff that generates the sentiments of gaming and industry right now are big publishers and big influencers. And what do you have? You have bipolar review system. It's either you hate it, either you hate it, or you absolutely love it. That's it. There's no normalization. And then as the not 80% of the other consumers, you get this averaging effect. It's like, oh, it's about this. But really, it's a bimodal distribution. When you take a bimodal distribution and you average it, it's uninformative. It's generally uninformative. You're going to have an experience that you absolutely hate, or you absolutely love in the other situation too. And then refunds go up, so it hurts devs, it hurts the store clients. So I'm really astonished that there isn't a model that straddles between the two. Because as much as I would like it, I'm trying to be as respectful to the big publishers and the big influence as possible, but their opinions and their opinions and their thought process comes from perspective of big money, big influence. That doesn't represent 80 to 85% of consumers. Like those are extraordinary cases. And they're trying to understand being in a position that is not big. That's an inherent human condition problem. You spend so much time being big. To me, I wouldn't blame them for always thinking big because they spend most of their time doing that. It's just interesting that there isn't a system that represents the vast majority of people, like the vast majority of consumer. This is true of not just the gaming industry, pretty much everything at the moment because of how the internet works. Nvidia doesn't gouge prices and stuff based on consumerism that represents 80% of the market, or 80% plus. They represent like the 10th percent, like the 95th percentile. So you have GPUs that 90% of people can't afford because there's no representation. It's kind of like I don't really want to use the United States government as a standard, but at least ironically, the United States government has representation that is still striving closer to representing different denominations and the majority than how industry is run in general, globally, internationally. It's just run by people who are big, and it's influenced and controlled and groomed by people who are big, which doesn't really represent the majority of people perspective. Just empathetically, like just emotionally, status-wise, it's just different. It's not bad, it's not good, but the fact is it doesn't represent the majority. That's, you can interpret it and feel the way you want, but the fact is, if you are big, you generally do not have the perspective of being small anymore. And the longer you spend being successful, the less and less time you spend having to deal or associate yourself with smaller problems. Perspective check, in my opinion. I've been reading a lot of reviews lately because Games Awards and all that stuff. And that's just it. And even I would say I can't think big. Like, I'm not big, so I don't know that stuff. And that's why it sounds like I'm criticizing them, but it's the same thing. I can't empathize with that. But it's mutual. They can't empathize my perspective either, most of the time. Anyways, that was a rant. Just for fun. While I rested a little bit. Okay, let's try this again. It's always such a adjustment when I first do this. Yeah, I'm trying to close in the gap. Yeah, see, that's what I mean. Oh my gosh. Alright. We've got some improvements, that's for sure. It's only been 45 minutes. And we still haven't tried the big one yet. We still haven't tried this. I'm gonna do like one or two reps. One or two reps of this and then... Yeesh. I timed out near the end. Just started relaxing a little too much near the end. I think we need to do like more than one of these. I think I should do a 2-to-1 ratio. Because these feel way less stamina heavy. Doing long streams is way less stamina heavy than stop and go for me. So we should do at least 2 repeats. Oops. I don't know why this keeps turning off every once in a while. Oops. A little rough here and there. Fingers skipped a little here and there. When it skips, it kind of twitches and it taps early, and then everything else early a little bit, and then it just resumes back to the same speed. I don't know if that twitching is ever gonna go away, but it's been there for a really long time. Not fast enough in like the middle portion. Slowly like slowing down over time. We're almost at the main event. Wow.
Nah, ain't no way why I can't this fucking be me goddamn but an eco love hypernauties.
Son, you got. Son, listen. You just gotta just say. Wait, Oh, that emote. I'm like, where did it just drop an F-bomb? Son, listen, we need to talk about that. Thanks for the sub. 41 months. Are you ready this evening for your tourney? Yeah. All right, I struggled a little near the end. It was my hand started tensing up. I was really trying to keep it loose. Hey, hello there. What do you mean we'll see? Ooh, how many in-betweens do you still have, Conference, to do? I have to do this again. Alright. 3 minutes. Seems like 3 minutes is generally the time duration we have. I do not do multis, no. Six total, three each for both characters. Okay. I can get one done a day, but I'll have to double up one day. That sounds very solid. Sounds like you have it all planned out. I can't wait to see the final product. Are you going to do post-editing at all? Are you going to do touch-ups and stuff? One thing that's very effective for animation in general is once you finish the motion of all your things, like your two characters, putting in static elements, like, you know, drawing in one thing in the environment that doesn't move, makes it grounds a lot of the things. So when you're done with all your in-betweens and your animation, you can go back and just put in very static things. And then you can put in two-frame things, which are fairly easy to do. Like, for example, you can put in a window and draw like a tree in the back, and you can have the tree move between just two frames. So it kind of looks like it's swaying back and forth. And those things you just keep consistently oscillating. So it can be very effective in drawing contrast with the thing you're moving. Hello there. Zooey. With lots of eyes. Alright. We gotta do this one more time. Let's go. Feels weird, man. Okay. Yeah, man, the fatigue is really setting in, but we're near the end. Yeah, start and stop and go, especially after resting, the early period is pretty hard to adjust when in fatigue or getting close to fatigue. And then once we normalize, there's some twitching. My hand keeps skipping a beat every once in a while. Is this for animation? Oh, I was talking to Coffers about animation, yeah. The stuff I was talking about. Alfred has an animation project that he needs to finish within a couple days. So we were just talking about that. Just some like typical artistry things. He's in class for animation. I do animation as a hobby, or I look at art and stuff for a hobby, so I was just suggesting ideas. Shortcuts that will make his project kind of like his professor might appreciate. I think we should just go for this now. I don't think I have enough. We just need to complete one rep. If we can complete one rep of this, we're ahead of schedule. Yesterday I failed to complete a rep. We attempted twice and it was like 50%, 75%. It was fairly close. 6 days. We're way ahead of schedule. I don't think I'm gonna be comfortably doing this for another 9 days, so we gotta keep at it. All right. Ow. Yikes. Oh, we got it. Oops. We're totally not playing that again. So much pain. I could have done better too. I actually slowed down in the middle portion. I like deliberately slowed down a little bit. I thought I was pacing myself, but I didn't need to pace myself. I was comfortable near the end. Not bad for 6 days. I wasn't expecting to be this far ahead. I'm like a week ahead of where I think I should be. I could barely do this on day one. But I didn't think I was gonna reach this point for another 6 days, maybe 6 or 7 days. Man, the difference, the difference in 2 days. Oh man. My hand is still shaking. My forearm is like really hard. Can't stop. It's like not relaxing. Oof. We tried this once as well 2 days ago. Only managed 4 minutes. Which is... This is only like 30 minutes longer than the month. This one. How long is this? All of these are so long! Oh, except for this one. Oh, man. Alright. Yeah, one of the big leaps in this is, while it's only a 6 BPM increase, it's a minute, over a minute and a half longer. That was a really big gap. Generally, you start at about a B, and then after a day or two, it becomes an A or a no miss. But this was a gigantic leap, like starting at a C. I was stamina gated. It was about this accuracy going in, and then near the end, I just couldn't keep up. I was shaking all over the place. I could barely even aim, even though there's no aim in this map. I could barely keep my cursor steady because my hand kept shaking. My whole body was shaking. This one, my cursor started shaking, my body wasn't shaking yet. We're behind on this though. In between, we're doing sustain, and it gets really hard jumping from this to this so far. But I need to be able to switch between the two very often. Alright, I guess we did the 155, so... Right here is our goal. You're gonna try to build... I think it's a... It looks like it's really fun, son. I think... Like, the reason why I'm falling behind with the long stream sustain thing is because this is a lot of fun. And I think this map set has pretty... I kind of like the... I'm okay with the songs they pick for this one. They're less like this. Like, this stuff is like... It's less interesting to listen to. But I do like... I do like the songs, like, overall. They could be worse, I guess. To me, they could be less interesting sounding. You mean like at what you call it, like 200 plus where you are, like 210, 220? Yeah, triples work way better. Son, I absolutely agree. Triples work way better. In fact, the reason why I started with triples, then I do like lower, is to make myself forget about finger locking. Yeah. So lately, even though this is 160 and I go down to like 140 here, I use this to break the fear of finger locking. I finger lock so much more often than you do, even like at your like peak speed. It's all over the place. So I do love tripling a lot. And it hurts so much, but it feels so nice. Like, when I say it's hurting, it's because my arm is burning. But it's like a good burn. It doesn't feel like there's any, like, stitches. You don't have stitches in your hand. It's just like your whole forearm is on fire. But it's a good fire. It's a very localized. And when you're zoned in, oof, it feels great. This is the fastest I've ever been, and it took 6 days. I've never been this fast. Not yet. Not up to this point. There's no way I could do triples for 4 minutes and 42 seconds, back to back. Like, I wouldn't have been able to imagine myself doing that. I've always played maps where triples come, like, every 30 to 30 seconds-ish. There might be, like, some triple spams, but they don't ever last more than 6 to 10 seconds, right? Throughout like a six minute map. It's like every 30 minutes there might be like a period of 10 or so seconds of triples. So this is at least 20 times faster than I've ever been in 6 days. My hand is still like really tight. But I've reached my goal for today. So now I can start cooling down after I try this one. This is my realistic goal here. And usually I'm trying to forget that I finger lock, just keep doing it. Hopefully my finger twitches too. So the difference between a finger lock and a twitch is, when you see a finger lock, you'll see a span of 50. And then it'll catch up to the normal speed. Like, in my head, my hands are still moving at the same speed, but you'll see a span of yellow. And in my head, I'm not saying I did that deliberately or I'm adjusting. I just continue. But when my hand twitches, you'll see that there's like four or five green early things, and then it would go back to the normal speed. So my goal for this type of practice is to just make it less often, I guess. But in my head, I don't think I'm doing it. I just keep on tapping the same way. Like, I'm not even adjusting. It just goes back to its normal speed. So that's what I'm using these for. It's not to get ack, I guess. Sorry, I'm like over streaming because of how tense I am from the last thing. I'm trying to get used to the visual. So I've been the way I've been learning how to time these streams is by looking at where the approach circle is with relative to the stream, how the circles are disappearing. But when it gets to 160 and the OD becomes 7, it's a different timing. Like the circle is just barely visible. So I'm not used to that. So this is the biggest change, even though it might not be a change for people who have like an internal metronome and whatnot. But anyways. It got normalized near the end. My forearm relaxed in the middle of it, which is good because I really was afraid it was like just stuck. Yeah, it's so much harder when you're like near your fatigue. Like not separating. My fingers aren't lifting. near the end, just finger lock, twitching, everything, and the could hold it for maybe like could probably do it only a minute and a half. I could probably do SS at OD7 for a minute and a half, but then it just falls apart and is completely. So it's pretty close. Optimistically, when rested. I would say right now, max 15 seconds, 15 to 30 seconds, like in the beginning, if I start correctly. Whoops. I rested for too long. It's definitely not a stamina problem. It's more of like a finger problem. Like this is well below my threshold, but like from the repeated pattern back and forth, my hand like sometimes tightens, sometimes loosens, sometimes tight, and then there's like double tapping and stuff. So I did not win a Steam Deck. Nope. Did you? I don't even know if it was working, to be honest. I'm not entirely sure if it was working, but like, I saw those winners being picked, but not lucky enough. Oh, but there is a Maku, though. There is a Maku, though. The OG one. That would have been interesting if I won something, but I didn't. I don't know if you can even claim. I don't even know how you would claim it. Do you know anyone that won a Steam Deck? No? Oh. I told everyone it. I was hoping someone I knew at least got a chance to win one. I would be really happy for them. I genuinely like watching game awards and stuff just to see what like the mass populace is excited about or what they feel. So it was a bonus that Steam was giving away Steam Decks. We have to at least give this a go, right? If we get to the end of this, I'm happy where I am on this stuff. On this, like, long stream stuff. I'm not very optimistic about the long stream stuff. We're just seeing where our tapping hand is right now before we retry and give it a focus go. I haven't completed this to the end in a while, only like 6 times, so getting to the end is bonus for me at this point, in a very fatigued state. Kind of unusual that I get a little bit more accurate when I'm fatigued. Oh no, wait, I did complete it a bunch of times. Actually, I was incorrect. I did complete it a couple times already. This is where I want to be right now at the moment for today. So it's pretty good. Thank you. Well, could be worse. Could be worse. Definitely could be worse. Now my forearm is very loose. So maybe we won't cool down today. Because we've already played an hour and 40 minutes. So we're 40 minutes over now. So we're not going to do a cool down today. Which is why I stepped down all the way down to the bottom again. One last try. I think I got like 3 minutes left in me. Oh, I was really early. Okay. So early. There's a gap in the middle that's different from the others. I can't maintain this speed. Yeah, I was slowing down. Dang it. I didn't realize there wasn't a break there. I was like slowly losing it. Holy, when the sound fades away, it makes me like I can't start and stop. Starting and stopping hurts so much. Like that pause and then have to do those five together. Oh man. Oh my freak! Oh my. My hand just like seized up at the. Oh my gosh. I felt a tear like started going down my left eye. Nice 4-star. I'm gonna be honest, it's probably easier to just like pass a 7-star than what I just did here. I think I'd rather try to pass a 7-star than do this, in my opinion. I legit my hand felt so like it's super like my left eye was starting to tear up from the pain. I was like, oh man, am I crying right? Ah, man. Oof. Oh, yeah, I know. The guys. Yeah. I know. What secretly though, low key, son, this is also making 9.5 normal. My weakest triples are any AR higher than 9.3 at 160 BPM plus. So anything above 160 BPM that's higher than an AR 9.3, and even this starts at a 9.4. This one is the weirdest to read because it's 9.7, but like what I mean is, since I rely so much on seeing the approach circle timed with the bounce off the circle, it's normalizing my sync. This is probably the lowest one. This one I'm early to, like I'm early to by a lot now, but it's just adjusting to. These ones are weird because, so this is what makes the stuff really weird for my streaming stuff. When long stream stuff, if they're low AR, they feel a lot more comfortable because I've been practicing, and most of these are like AR8. So whenever there's a stream that comes out that's like 9.2, I'm overaiming. I overaim all those streams. So it's the source of the reason why I overaim on long streams. And then I'm early to triples. Or I mean, I'm late to triples past a certain BPM, and I'm early to triples below a certain BPM. So there's a gap in this, in these sets. Like they don't mix and match and cover the AR gap. So I make that up by playing maps. So what feels natural is weird because I think long stream should be low AR. And then I think bursts should be like higher AR than... But anyways, we did it! Now I'm gonna slack off for the next 7 days. Nah, I'm just kidding. We're gonna keep pushing. If this keeps up, realistically, I will get here. Like, Without a doubt, I'll get here in 30 days. Without a doubt. Now, we're way, way ahead. Unless I lose my motivation or something, we'll get to here in 30 days. But this is, completing this entire set is very realistic now. But we'll see. This, I don't think I'm gonna get to 180. I'm gonna be honest, mate. I'm not sure if I'm gonna get to 180. I think the realistic is probably this last one down here. In 30 days, but we'll see. And then because of where I am now, we can start playing this. Not today though. My arms are so burned out. It's not gonna be possible anymore. Actually, what time is it? It's 5 p.m. Plenty of time. But really, we can finally play this because the slowest sustained speed I have is 163. And the highest, like, stop-go stamina I have is 180. So this is way more comfortable now to go and do this. I mean, to tell you the truth, if we're gonna go passing, right? Like, if we're going for passes, I probably could do like two. I can probably do like here and here, but it would be like a C. Like, passing is kind of fun sometimes, but to me, I'm past that point. All pun intended. I'm past the point where passing is not, it doesn't, like, if you read a map enough, right? If you play a map enough, you can pass it. Just spam your heart out. I'm gonna say it's probably here and here is where I would get the C. But it's about the act game, right? We kind of, this map here, I'm using this map set as the act game for the combination of sustain and stop go. stop, go, burst, and sustain. So hopefully we can work up to it. Like, I'm not gonna do these just because I can pass them. I think this is a pretty good range right now. I was doing these because of the AR change. I was seeing if the AR change would make it more comfortable, but they're all about the same. It's just the song and the tapping issue. There's no... What is my highest? I think 225 is probably my highest. When it, if I threw out ACK and AIM and stuff, 225 is probably the highest. But that's like... It doesn't really mean anything if you're not... If you really don't feel the map, right? If you're not actually playing the map. I tried a lot. Look at this, son. It's not like I didn't try. Wait, hold up. Let's find out. Let's play it like one time. Yeah, I'll know. I'll know in the first burst right away if my hand can start anymore. We'll find out. Ooh. Oh my gosh. It's okay. I think I can start and stop still. I haven't played this in a while, in like the last 2 days. Like, really focused. I overaim. I'm like overaiming in general, which makes a lot of sense based on what I've been practicing. We'll be right back. Sometimes when you start on time, it's okay. Sometimes when I don't, it's very tiring. It's all right. We won't really get to it for a while. We could probably do something like... We might have to start on this first, to be honest. Yeah, just too tired in general. Okay. Alright. Now I'm gonna go and play some relaxing Across the Obelisk. Oh, we reached our goal. We exceeded our goal today. Alright, so what did we learn today? I think we're gonna still warm up with this. So we're gonna warm up with this step up. Maybe like warm up one try each time. So warm up one. So we warm up this. Warm up here. We're gonna do this just once for warm up. Then we do warm up here. Then here. And then we're gonna stick with this. We're gonna step up one more time and hope to warm up with this. We'll double this, probably. We'll double warm up here and then do this one more time, and then we'll call that a warm up. That'll be our new base warm up, and then we step up. We keep stepping up. 160. Maybe tomorrow we'll get to like here. And then we'll continue to increase our reps on these two. We'll start with this as the peak and then step down, and we can't reach the end of Blue Nation, I guess. All right. Sweet. The Blue Nation, the way it lines up with the triples kind of get me pumped. Alright. Good practice day. We're almost a week in. Tomorrow is going to be a week of this.